Okay, my name is John Cruz, and this is their 2003-2004 RadNet MSK lecture series for the MSK fellows. I'll be giving most of the lectures. Along with me will be John Yergudis, who will introduce himself. John?
I'm John Yergudis. I'm an orthopedic surgeon. Used to be a professor at USC. Took care of crippled children at orthopedic hospital, and took care of football teams on the weekends during the season at colleges and high school, and that's about it.
Thanks, John.
All right, my name is Tayson. I'm one of the fellows.
Hi, my name is Elior.
Hi, my name's Robert. I'm another one of the fellows.
Thank you. Okay, so we'll start out with the knee, and during through the course of the year, we'll go through the major joints and then some basic pathophysiology of the musculoskeletal system. So the knee, we'll talk about technical factors, and then we'll go in and talk about menisci, ligaments, synovium. And we'll have an overall lecture on masses. We don't really have enough time this year to have a lot of lectures on the specific masses of each of the different joints and so forth, but we'll have a general soft tissue and bone lectures. Technical factors, you can talk about field strength and different scanner designs, and then we won't spend a lot of time with protocols. People have protocols at different places now. They're pretty well standardized, and there are a lot of different ways to do good scanning of the different joints. Some of the scanners that we will be reading for this year include extremity scanners. This is an Ortho 1. It comes in both 1 and 1.5 tesla varieties. We work with one in San Francisco that's a 1 tesla variety, and you can see you can just stick your knee in. Not much problem with claustrophobia in these particular cases. But it limits the field of view, and it obviously limits us to only extremity imaging. And then we'll use large magnets that you're all familiar with. So let me ask a question here. Let's start out with Tayson. Is 3T superior to 1.5T when it comes to musculoskeletal imaging of the joints?
I suppose not, since this question is being asked.
Okay. Well, the answer in this particular paper was no. And certainly my experience over the years is there's very little difference in diagnostic ability between 3T and 1.5T. There are some more advanced sequences that are better performed at higher field than 1.5T, in large part because you get much better signal to noise at 3T, or you can get better signal to noise at 3T, depending upon how it's technically done, such as with diffusion imaging and some other fancier imaging. But for standard techniques, though a lot of people think of 3T as better, what happened in the early days of when 3T was first introduced, there were often new scanners and people were comparing them to old 1.5T scanners. So they looked better. But then when you use the same technology to improve 1.5T scanners, really, the difference was not that significant. I think, as John alluded to earlier when we were talking, I think it's different in the brain. I think that 3T is diagnostically a little bit superior to 1.5T in the brain, but I haven't really found that in the musculoskeletal system. And we do find that we have a little bit less artifact with 1.5 than 3T, but I think they're pretty much equivalent. So the question is, big problem that we have, especially in the past, not so much now, is a metal artifact. It's a little bit less now because in sports medicine and orthopedics, surgeons have tried to get away from metallic hardware that produces a lot of artifact. It's hard sometimes in the spine to get away from it, but in the joints, usually these large amounts of artifact like we see here or with older surgeries and the newer surgeries. The problem is that a lot of the older technology that gives a lot of artifact, it has actually a metallic type, a metal tend to be less expensive. So some people don't want to opt for paying more in order to get better quality imaging down the line. But fortunately, the newer hardware has become less expensive and is more competitive. But there are a number of things that we can do to improve this. One is use a stir technique instead of a PD FatSat. When we do the lecture, if we do the physics lectures, we'll talk about the difference between those two and why stir imaging gives much less metal artifact and than fat-suppressed imaging. But we'll talk about that later. So that's a common thing to do is if you see this or the tech sees it, they'll just add a stir sequence to give us the information with less artifact. And there are also, there are a lot of more advanced techniques now which try to acquire the images and do the reconstructions in a manner to minimize the metal artifact, which are somewhat helpful, but you still tend to not able to completely get rid of metal artifact when you have it postoperatively. Here's just another example. Here's an example where you can see the metal artifact that obviously causes problems, but it's helpful to get rid of it. Once you get rid of it, you realize that this stuff is all metal artifact, and this is actually acute trabecular bone injury, which was the cause of the patient's symptoms. Here, you might just assume that this is metal artifact as well. So getting rid of the artifact can be helpful in a diagnostic reasons. I'd like to talk a little bit about arthrography. Here we can see that there is an oblique tear. In the past, we often had a problem if people had primary repairs of the meniscus, and that you can get scarring, which can have persistent increased signal intensity. So people would like to do an arthrogram to see if you actually get contrast into the lesion. If that's the case, then it's considered generally to be a recurrent tear or breakdown in the repair. Whereas if you don't see arthrography going into it, it's kind of assumed to be scar tissue. That kind of turned out not to be very reliable. And I really don't think that this is any more considered a good indication for doing arthrography. And in general, I don't like doing arthrography because as soon as you stick a needle in the joint, start distending the joint, you're no longer physiologic. And you can also get extravasation, which can be a real problem, especially if you have acute injury, because then you'll get increased signal intensity, as we'll see in the soft tissues. They can look a lot like a tear within the muscles, and it's often hard to differentiate the two, but we'll have further examples. The bottom line in the knee is I really don't believe that MR arthrography of the knee is really indicated anymore. It was popular in the early days of MR because a lot of the radiologists were used to doing arthrography. They felt comfortable with arthrography, so they like to kind of continue that with MR, but I really don't believe there are any indications for MR arthrography in the knee anymore. Here's an example of someone who had a medial meniscal tear, had a primary repair of the meniscus, and we'll talk about how that's considered the optimal treatment for the right people. And we'll talk about that because it's our role to make a diagnosis of the tear, and you have to go beyond that to determine whether it's a tear that's best treated by no surgery, treated by partial meniscectomy, or by primary repair. And MR can be very helpful in helping with that. That dilemma. And here we can see that it's not very bright on the T2 weighted image, a little bit brighter on the photon density fat suppressed image. And this is a good repair in someone who had a meniscal tear that was primarily repaired. And here again, you can get persistent signal intensity within an area where you can have scar tissue in the repair process. Let me see here. Okay, Elior, what do you think's going on with the menisci here?
Okay, so we've got coronal views here. On the right, got a PD.
So it's a T1 on the left, T1 it's a PD fat set on the right.
Yes. So in the medial meniscus on the PD fat set image, you see some high signal intensity. In maybe the posterior horn or the body.
Let's see, we're right in the middle of the joint here, and this is the medial collateral ligament.
Okay, so the body.
Yeah, so do these look like normal anatomy for the menisci?
Oh, no, these look like discoid. Okay. Menisci, actually.
Okay, it could be a discoid, but then it's kind of funny because it's going all the way across here.
Yeah.
It doesn't really stop like a menisci does. This is someone who had a MR arthrogram of the knee. This is what the images look like. Ideas?
Okay.
No. So this is too concentrated a contrast.
Okay.
If you put it, the gadolinium, which is too concentrated, it causes dephasing of the spins right away, and you get no signal intensity on any of the pulse sequences.
I see.
So this is all artifact because the concentration of the contrast was too high. So you have to dilute it by a factor of about 200 in order to do it properly. So what would you do in this situation if you realized all of a sudden, oh my gosh, I forgot to dilute the contrast?
I mean, would it just be non-diagnostic and you'd have to wait until they excrete the contrast and just maybe repeat the exam?
So you get asked to repeat the exam in about an hour or two.
Okay.
And it would be better. So this is what it looks like when the contrast is not adequately diluted.
Okay.
And this is another example where it's not adequately diluted. And you can see it's picking up. The actual articular cartilage on the superficial layer is picking up some of the gadolinium, producing a little bit of an enhancement. And here the it's diffused into the cartilage and is less concentrated. Therefore, you'll get more of a typical enhancement pattern.
Mm-hmm.
And again, so that's what this was diluted only 1:1. So if you go out and you see images like this, then you'll have some idea of what might be going on. Or you can bring them back the next day. Robert, what do you think of this case?
So we got, was the T1 and PD fat set coronals of the knee.
So this is another arthrogram. Mm-hmm. So what do you see here?
Looks like laterally there's a little bit of blunting of the free edge of the meniscus.
What we're worried about is what's happening.
Looks like there's some chondromalacia there. This would be grade 4 chondromalacia with like full thickness cartilage loss and underlying reactive change.
Okay, John, did you have something? Okay. So go ahead, John.
This is actually a divot in the condyle. It's an injury, probably playing ball or running or tripping or whatever. And so what you see is a chondral fracture in that area.
Well, what we see here at this point, we see a little bit of high signal deep to the cartilage here. And we see some low signal intensity on the T1, which means you've replaced the fat, and a little bit of high signal intensity on the PD fat sat. So this is probably granulation tissue deep to this area. And then and here is the T2 edited image. And what we want to see is whether there's a defect in the cartilage here. But again, this was not the concentration was too high of the contrast. So you had to really dilute it a lot. So what we decided to do in this particular case is to bring this was originally done on 7103. We brought the patient back. The patient probably came back 2 days later. And this is what the sagittal T2 weighted image look at that location.
Okay. So there's a little bit of irregularity of that articular cartilage, but I think it looks relatively intact.
Yeah. So we'll have a lot of lectures on cartilage, and we'll talk about what the cartilage is supposed to look like on the different sequences. So what we have here, John was right, is what happened is we have a subchondral injury here, but in this particular case, the articular cartilage is still intact overlying it. And that's what we wanted to know, because this is not something you're really going to want to approach arthroscopically if the cartilage is intact in this patient. So we just brought the patient back and did this. And we'll talk about using PD fat-sat versus T2 non-fat suppressed to look at the surface. And we find that both of them are very helpful, but the surface is best visualized with non-fat suppressed images. And you can get a lot of false positives if you just use fat suppressed images to look at the surface of the articular cartilage. And we'll talk about that later. So with MR arthrography, this was a paper from Maggie et al. In radiology in 2003, where they said MR arthrography indications was if you have greater than a 25% partial meniscectomy of the posterior horn, they recommend doing arthrography and not regular imaging. And if you did it after primary or meniscal repair, you just had to make sure you diluted it properly. So as we'll talk about now, partial tears generally are no longer considered surgical candidates unless you have an unstable meniscus, or if it's acute, if you're really looking at doing a primary repair. In that situation, I don't think arthrography is helpful. And then if you're looking for primary meniscal repair, we've just found that arthrography is, in my experience, has turned out not to be any more helpful than using standard imaging, using intrinsic fluid as a contrast agent. So even though this was published at that time, I think most people kind of agree that MR arthrography is really no longer really an indicated procedure.
The surgery is done in individuals that have an acute tear and have symptoms like effusions and pain. But if it's a degenerative tear, you can ignore it until the pain goes away. Maybe non-weight bearing on using a walker, a cane, or crutches. Usually the pain goes away in the posterior horn, and people do not need surgery. Before MRI, surgery was very common because we were going blind, basically. Even with arthrograms that we had, well, we got pretty good at reading arthrograms, but not nearly as well as we have now with MRI. So acute tears are a little different than degenerative tears.
Yeah, and we'll definitely go through that, how to tell the difference. Thank you, John. They said, what do you see here? This is a coronal image through the patella. What are we seeing here?
Okay, we see, there's a T1 on the left and a PD facet on the right. We see susceptibility artifact along the medial border of the patella, right? I don't know. Is this a...
We're seeing low signal here. It's probably not susceptibility artifact. Susceptibility artifact means that you're displacing signal and you get little areas of high signal where the computer algorithm misinterprets where the signal is coming from.
Okay.
So we have low signal intensity here adjacent to the patella, and for whatever reasons, here are the axial images. So what do you see here on the axial images?
There is an effusion with a fluid level. So
okay,
and the hematoma
top
maybe?
Is black and the bottom is white on these T2 non-fat suppressed images. So what's going on here?
T2 non-suppressed images.
Okay, so you got obviously two different kinds of fluids here.
Yeah.
Liquids. Top one is low in signal, the bottom one is bright on the T2. And this is someone who just had a hyaluronic acid
Oh.
injection, and the acid is floating on top, and there's a lot of dephasing in the signal, so we don't get signal there, and then we got regular fluid on the bottom, which is bright. So this, if you see this, this is typically if you this patient was scanned right after they had a knee injection.
I see.
I'm not a proponent of hyaluronic acid, and it doesn't help with regards to using MRI.
Okay, great. Okay, so this is from Dr. Tierman, a 70-year-old male. They want to be concerned about a meniscal tear, but he was concerned about what is this thing here?
So we see linear low signal in the medial, no, the lateral compartment.
Well, it's a
No, that's
lateral
lateral
aspect of the medial
compartment.
compartment, right?
Okay.
So this is the lateral compartment, this is the medial compartment, there's a medial collateral ligament, and this is the lateral part. And then here's this is a PD fat sat image, I think here. So what could this low signal be there?
Gosh.
Well, it's lateral, so it could be a discoid lateral meniscus, right?
Yeah.
You can
Yeah.
also get discoid medial, but they're much less common. And here's a gradient echo technique, which we don't do very often, but this is kind of helpful because it looks different than meniscal tissue on the gradient echo, doesn't it? It's much blacker, and you've got these little dots here. So what do you think is going on here? So this is
Yeah,
what
for
interarticular gas looks like. And if they're lying in the scanner, especially if they lie a while and it's a little bit distracted, you can pull nitrogen gas into the knee joint.
sure.
And I just want you to see these things so that you can kind of think through the process. And when you see these clinically, you won't be confused by them.
Okay.
So this is just interarticular gas, and it's usually nitrogen. So now, again, we're just talking about technical things here before we get into pathology. Now, this is, we did a study a couple of years ago where we were trying to correlate articular cartilage disease seen on MR with the size and location of the articular cartilage disease at arthroscopy. And as what we found is that the arthroscopist and the radiologist could look at the arthroscopic video and agree on articular cartilage size, shape, and location. Both the orthopedic surgeon and the radiologist could look at the MR exam and agree the size, shape, and location of articular cartilage. But when we actually look at the correlation between surgery and MR, there was almost no correlation. The location was different, the number of lesions were different. So we scratch our head to see what's going on here. And then one of the fellows involved came up with the idea, well, maybe we're not really looking at what we think we're looking at. So he took five cadaver knees, and they did arthroscopy on the cadaver knees and looked at lesions. Then they took them and did an MR scan on the cadaver knees. Then they disarticulated the cadaver knees and did both histology and gross specimen evaluation of the knees to see what the hell was going on. And as what we found is that what the arthroscopist considers as the anterior articular cartilage of the lateral compartment is this narrow little area right in here. We were saying the anterior part was all this area up through here. The middle central part of the joint, this is where the arthroscopist saw it. And the posterior aspect, this is what the arthroscopist saw. And the entire far posterior area of the articular cartilage is not visualized at arthroscopy using standard arthroscopic portals. And we didn't know that. And I'm going to go through this study in detail when we talk about articular cartilage, because he actually went in and put in suture anchors at the margins of what he could see. So we have MR scans showing where the suture anchors are, and then we also had the gross specimens to evaluate. And it turned out that MR and the gross specimens correlated very well. And once we realized that these were the locations that the arthroscopist was looking at, and large areas were not seen by the arthroscopist, one, we realized that we picked up a lot more lesions on MR than we picked up at arthroscopy, but they were in areas which were blinded to the arthroscopist. The arthroscopist actually picked up a few more in the areas where they could see because they have much higher resolution than we have. And there's the media side, what it looks like. Yes, John.
I don't believe that you guys used a needle scope.
No, we use a standard diagnostic sports medicine arthroscope.
Right, and with a needle scope, you can see much more. Yeah. You can see the entire knee, even in a baby. So, if you use an if you run into a situation like this where the MRI is positive, but arthroscopically you can't see it in that area, prepare yourself and use a needle scope. There's nothing wrong with using a needle scope. Of course, this procedure can be done from different portals, which changes the surgery. If you can prepare for it, you can do it probably almost at the same time as it would take with a usual scope, which is 4.5 yeah. millimeters in diameter.
Yeah. The important thing here for the radiologist is to realize that if you have a lesion back here, and they're quite common, and we'll go through the statistics, then it's got to be conveyed in your report that it's in the far posterior zone. And then you can see them arthroscopically, like John says, if you use needle scope, but if you want to do a repair procedure, you can't really do that with a needle scope. You can either do different portals, or you can position the knee in different positions in order to be able to see the area, but that's not standard unless you know that there's a lesion outside of the normal area that you're looking at. So that's why this
is correct. One other problem with the lateral compartment, it's very tight. And to operate on the lateral side, either arthroscopically or with an incision, is difficult. So that's another problem with the lateral compartment. It is a very tight compartment. It's not like the medial side.
Right.
So you're kind of if you're going to have an injury in this area, your patient is kind of in trouble.
Okay. Ilya,
are these red zones all the arthroscope can see?
These are what the arthroscope, using standard portals without doing anything fancy, okay. This is what they can see from here to here, and they consider this anterior, this central, and this posterior. And I'll go through this in much more detail later, and I'll go through, and you'll see on the images, because they actually put suture anchors in where these margins were, so we can see where the margins are on the MR examination.
So the anterior horn, they can miss as well.
Yeah, up here as well. Okay. That's correct.
Okay.
Yeah. And this is, okay. Now, the other thing to remember is you can do CT arthrography of the knee. And if it's someone who can't get a do an MR scan, though, we very rarely do this. But you can see a meniscal tear on CT arthrography as well. And they have the standard criteria that we use. And the other thing, I'll show that later. Okay. See, who's next? Roberto.
So we have a sagittal, I think it's a T1 or PD, sorry, PD sagittal rollout meniscal tear. Looks like there's some oblique signal on that posterior horn. Yeah, right there.
Okay. So it's a tear, right?
Correct.
Okay. We were concerned about that. Mm-hmm. So the tech redid the scan. And this is what it looked like within minutes.
Motion.
What did the tech tell the patient?
Stop moving.
Between the two. And if you look here, you see all these little lines. Mm-hmm. You see these repeated lines here. And you see these lines here.
Mm-hmm.
This is all motion artifact. So be aware. Sometimes, you know, this really looks like a tear. But if you have lines that parallel sharp interfaces, then that's classic for motion. And be very, very careful. As you can see here, this meniscus was perfectly fine. So these artifacts can be a problem if you have motion. And so overall, when you first look at the images, you should kind of gauge for signal to noise, motion, and any other quality issues. And if you see motion, you need to go into your skeptical mode.
If there wasn't a repeat, would you say you can't rule out a tear, or would you say because there's motion surrounding it, it's probably motion artifact?
Or would you corroborate it with the other views to confirm your finding?
Yeah. Yes. So we looked at the other views, and we didn't see this on the other views. This is also very uncharacteristic for the morphology of a tear in the posterior horn, as you'll see going forward. But if I was concerned and I didn't have the repeat image, then I would qualify it. Yeah. And
so wouldn't you say that's a very unusual appearance of a tear?
Yes, I certainly would. And as we'll talk about later on, let's wait till we get to later on. Sorry about that. Okay. Jason.
All right. We have a fluid sensitive fat SAT sequence, sagittal view of the knee, in the medial compartment.
Okay.
I'm not sure that's a fat sat, though.
Yeah, it is.
It is, John?
It is, yeah.
Okay.
So it looks like the anterior horn is protruding anteriorly.
Can overlap there a little bit. Okay.
And I guess the posterior.
What are those images of that black?
What's this?
Image on the condyle and the white image on the tibial side.
That looks like maybe some.
Those are artifacts.
Pulsation artifact of some
what?
Sort. Some. Right, pulsation artifact of.
We don't really have any vessels in the field, so they're probably not pulsation. Mm-hmm. But these are motion.
That patient is a little Xanax or something.
So, you know, these can be weird, but they're displaced at regular intervals. There's probably a little tiny one here that's not seeing very well. But these motion artifacts sometimes can be subtle. Their separation depends upon the periodic motion. And how it correlates with the phase encoding. They're always in the direction of the phase encoding. And in areas where you know there's motion, like if you're near a great vessel or something, you always have to select the direction of the phase encoding so that if there are any artifacts like this, it projects some over areas that aren't critical. And we'll see areas in the body where that's important, where you could really get poured problems with diagnosis if you don't do the phase encoding in the correct direction. So that's just other forms. So, unfortunately, or fortunately, I guess, however, we do have to do knee imaging with arthroplasty implants. And technically, to try to decrease the metal artifact, we can increase readout bandwidth or use any of the commercial metal reduction signatures, such as CMAC or Maverick, depending upon which manufacturer you have. And these can be helpful, but they don't always completely alleviate the problem. So, with arthroplasty implants, here are the common pathologies that you look for. Fortunately, now the new polyethylene that's used, the wear is almost non-existent anymore. So this is no longer at the top of the list with the new, better quality implants. You also look for aseptic loosening, which can be a problem with MR because this is what you're trying to see is the interface right between the hardware and the bone. And if it's metal that produces a lot of artifact, that's the area that's really obliterated that you can't see with MR. But you look to see if there's any separation or fluid between interface between the hardware and the bone itself. You look for instability of the implant. We'll see examples of all these during the course of the year. Main thing you want to look for right away is infection. And we'll see a number of those, so you'll get to see what infection looks like, but basically a lot of edema in the surrounding soft tissues and in the bone, typically with infection. We've for arthrofibrosis, malalignment, sensor mechanism, AVN, and then periprosthetic fractures are an important one, but according to this, it's only about 3%. So those are the common pathologies that we're looking for. Okay, let's see. Actually, why don't we? Now let's go ahead. We'll finish up with this. So, Elior, if you did a study of asymptomatic adults and you just did a bunch of MR of the knees on them, how commonly would you see each of the abnormalities listed there? What's your estimate?
Like in a percentage,
Yeah, percent.
meniscal tears, maybe
Totally asymptomatic.
30%.
Okay, cartilage.
Cartilage, oh, 70%.
Wow. Bone.
A bone,
Bone edema.
edema. I'd say that's low, maybe like 10, 5, 10%.
Okay, tendon
Tendon.
pathology.
I'd say, yeah, 5, 10% again, low.
Okay, and ligaments.
I'd say that'd be low as well, maybe 5%.
Okay. And then overall, what percentage do you think you'll see at least one positive finding in an asymptomatic adult?
Yeah,
Okay.
75%.
Well, you're pretty good actually. So about 30% of adults will have tear by both MR and arthroscopy, but this was an MR study. Cartilage is, as you said, was very high. I think you said 70, 62. Bone pathology is very common also in people who have asymptomatic knees, tendon less so. And ligament injuries are very uncommon because they're probably cause symptoms. And then overall, though, you'll almost never see a normal MR examination. This is, if you ever get involved in medical legal work, like John and I have been for years, this is an important thing to know because everybody, the lay people, kind of assume that the MR is going to be negative in asymptomatic adults. But it's not. They often have significant findings. So why don't we stop here and we'll pick up again tomorrow and go on and talk about anatomic variants and then maybe we'll have time to start the meniscal lectures tomorrow. Okay? Any questions? Okay.
Have a good evening, everybody.
Thanks,
You
John.
too.